I think the best way to manage parent involvement is to be proactive. There's a couple ways you can do that, and be clear about your expectations about their role in the program and your expectations of them as supporters of your program and parents to the athletes of the program, and not getting too over invested in terms of their involvement in the coaching staff decisions in your program. You can have a parent meeting, and in high school I know that's pretty common, in college not so much. However, I have heard of increasingly more coaches at the college level that are doing parent meetings. If not for the whole team, then for sure for first year players, to sort of lay the, you know, ground rules or rules of engagement with the program. So you could do that, and that's one of the reasons why I had you plan for an agenda for a parent meeting, so that you can be sure to address your expectations of them in the program. Or you could do a letter to them that clearly states and is in writing your expectations of their role as part of your program. Because remember, it is your program. It's your program that you are overseeing. And so you have the right to express that you want them involved a little bit, not at all, or anywhere in between, or a lot, or anywhere in between, right? So I personally think that taking a step like this can be very helpful in terms of how you can manage or mitigate any concerns or issues that a parent might bring up in the future, if that should happen. I know that when I sent letters to my parents, when I started doing that, that made a huge difference in how parents would send me or interact with me or question me, because I was very clear in the letters to them what I expected from them in terms of their behavior and the way that they would address me or try to address me, and pretty much the fact that they were not allowed to come to talk to me about playing time. I pretty much explicitly said that in the letter. Like, I will not discuss playing time. I will not discuss playing time with you. My athlete has an issue with that, they are an adult and they can come and address it with me. And I rarely had questions about playing time, and I knew when parents were upset about it. I could see when they were upset about it. I could see when they started, you know, having little mini conversations, in instances, you know, after games in the lobby. I could tell when parents were upset about things. But if their daughter didn't come to talk to me about it, then I saw it as a non-issue, because trust me, your athletes know better than their parents could ever understand why they are or are not playing. They know it. They know it deep down. They may not like it, and they may commiserate with their parent and express that they don't get it either, or they don't understand why either. But trust me, they know. They know. They're at practice every day. They see themselves measuring up with their fellow teammates. They've heard you say to them, you're not doing X, Y, and Z, or you're not working hard enough, you're slacking off, whatever it is. They hear it and they know it. They're just afraid to tell their parent, right? And or they just don't want to acknowledge the fact, or they don't want to face the fact that maybe they really aren't as good as they either hoped, wanted to be, or they were expecting to be, or maybe were told that they were going to be by the coach. That's a whole separate issue. If a coach, when you're being recruited or when you're discussing things at the beginning of a season, says to you, you're going to be our number one player, or you're going to be in our starting lineup, or you're going to be our major point getter, and you doesn't live up to the expectation, that's a whole other kind of conversation. But really, honestly, like, usually athletes know why they're not playing, or they kind of have a good sense of it. And they're just afraid to sort of talk to those things about their parents. So it's easier just to sort of, you know, bellyache and complain and, you know, gripe and moan about not playing and being frustrated by it. And parents sort of, or the athletes playing into the parents' frustration about not playing. Now, it is not to say that there are instances where maybe players don't understand. It doesn't seem to make sense. There doesn't seem to be an equal, an equitable decision being made about who gets to start or who is first, you know, subs off the bench or who gets to be in the scoring, you know, the scoring lineup versus the, just the competitive line or the additional competitors lineup or et cetera, right? Like, there are instances where that is the case, and there are coaches who have a harder time explaining why decisions are made about playing time. I will tell you, you might be in those positions sometimes too, where you're making decisions about playing time, and it might be hard for you to explain other than it's a gut reaction or an instinct, or you just feel this is the best for the team. And sometimes that's legitimate. I mean, it really is legitimate sometimes. It may feel unfair, or it may seem not calculated enough or, you know, pragmatic enough for some people, even maybe for you rationally. But the fact of the matter is sometimes as a coach, we do go on instinct, and especially in situations where you have to make quick decisions. You know, so sometimes the best laid plans don't work out for coaches. You may have like a perfect rotation in mind or a way that you're going to make sure you get certain people in the lineup. And then things happen, you know, game time action happens that is unpredictable. And so you may on the spot change your mind or, you know, whatever. So like, I'm not saying that necessarily there aren't situations, and sometimes you may have found yourself in a situation where you're like, yeah, actually, Coach Jay, I have no idea why I didn't play. I'm not saying that isn't actually real, but a good majority of the time, athletes do know why they're not playing. They're just sort of afraid to talk to their parents, or they don't want to address it with their parents, or it's just easier to just let their parents, you know, complain and play into that. Please realize, like, this is your program. It's your decisions to be made. This is where the thick skin I mentioned in the first intro video comes in, because you will be criticized all the time. I mean, it's remarkable how empowered people feel to criticize coaches. This is like one of the industries where professionals get criticized more from people who are not in the industry than probably any other industry out there, right? I always used to say to my players, I'm not going to go into your parents' workplace and criticize what they do. They do not have the right to come in here and criticize what I do, even if your parent coached before in the past. You know, you can question, of course, like, why would they do that? I mean, I do that a lot, right? Like, why would a coach make that decision? Why wouldn't they bench that person? Why wouldn't they get so-and-so back on the floor? But to actively go and criticize and question a coach, it's remarkable how many people feel empowered to do that and like they have a right to do that. So you are going to experience that. And my best suggestion to you is to grow thick skin and have confidence that you know more than anybody else what your team needs, because you do. You do know more than anybody else what your team needs. You look at your players every single day. You consider their strengths and weaknesses on a regular basis. You're looking at, if you're in a team sport, how they play with and amongst one another every single day. You're talking with your coaching staff. You're listening to the players and how they interact with each other. You're talking to them one-on-one, and you're hearing how they interact with one another, what their team chemistry is like, and what you know, what people are doing to impact team culture. You are seeing and looking at these things all the time, every day, all day. This is your world. Everybody else is looking at it from their very individual lens, right? Their child's lens, the parent of their child, and that is the one singular person that they are concerned about. That is the one singular person that they want everything for to go the right way. You do not have that luxury. You have to think about all the people on your team. So you need to keep that in perspective, that you know better than anyone everything that goes into making decisions about your team. Nobody else knows that like you do, not even your assistant coaches. Because even as a head coach, you'll know things about your players that you may not share with your assistant coaches. And I mean that in terms of like personal concerns that an athlete might have, or even just history that you've individually had with a player that you maybe aren't sharing with an assistant coach because you don't want them to get caught up in unnecessary information that's not going to help this, you know, not going to help them actively coach that athlete, right? So, you know, there's just so many things that you know so much more about with your team and the athletes than anybody else does. So when someone comes to question you, a parent, and you know that you've made the best decisions for the team in that moment or at that time, stick to your guns. Be confident in it. Have the conviction that you know better than anybody else, because you do, what is best for your team, right? And again, if I'm going to just, my only caveat with that is if it's a concern about health and safety, listen to what the concern is, even if the way that it's being delivered is really aggressive or in, like, trying to be intimidating or accusational. Listen to what the concern is. Filter out the delivery. Listen to the message. And then ask yourself, is that actually a legitimate concern? Or why are they having that concern? Is there something that they're seeing or perceiving that's not accurate? Do I need to address that? And if so, then do so. Or at least address it, even if there is nothing that needs to be changed, but address it so that people understand that you hear the concern and understand the concern, and you're going to alleviate their concern by saying or addressing it this way, right? So, but when it comes to playing time and when athletes play, like, you better believe that you know better than anybody else what's going on. Now, will you still make mistakes about playing time? Yeah, you will. Trust me, you will. I mean, I've finished games and, like, after the game, a couple hours after the game, after analyzing, I'm like, wow, I really should have played so-and-so, or man, I should have taken them off the floor, and I should have tried this combination or something. Like, oh my gosh, we're going to overanalyze our decisions all the time. We're going to beat ourselves up enough that we don't need additional people to beat ourselves up, to beat us up on the decisions we make. So could you have actually made a different decision about playing time? Sure, absolutely, probably. But that's why you say, in the moment, at the time, or at this time, I'm making the best decisions for this team that I see need to be made. Does it mean you're not going to look at it and analyze and maybe make a different decision later? No, that's not what that means. What it means is that you made the best decision at the time with the information you had, with what was happening, to do what you did. And so then you'll maybe make a decision later, different decision later. But you at that moment were doing the best you could with the information you had with how the situation was playing out. So I don't know if that can help you, just to remember you really do know more than anybody else. And so don't ever forget that and take that for granted, that parents are looking at the program with a singular lens through their child's, you know, through their child. And they're only hearing that person's perspective. That's the only perspective they're hearing. Maybe they're hearing something, maybe they're hearing things from teammates, you know, in the case of, like, maybe they go out to dinner with some of the team, or maybe some of the team goes and visits, you know, at a player's house, and they're chatting about things or whatever. But pretty much their only source of information about your program is through their child. And so, again, everything is very lopsided in terms of information they're getting. They're not there every day to see the ins and outs of what you're doing and how the team is interacting and what particular players are doing. So you know best. You know best for your program. So that's why, again, what I was saying at the very top of this video, having something at the beginning of the season that goes out to parents, whether that's via a meeting or a letter, that's pretty explicit about what your expectations are of your interaction with them and their interaction with the team, is very helpful, right? So, you know, be aware of that. Now, I will say you can probably, you can make decisions for yourself how much you want parents to interact. You know, I have coaches that don't allow parents to stay at the same hotel as them when they travel. But some coaches are fine with it. They don't mind. I have some coaches that are okay with having families eat dinners after competitions with the team, but not before. So anything beforehand can't happen. Anything after, fine. And then I have some coaches who don't allow families at all. and some that allow any time, doesn't matter, and players can eat with their families if they're at team meals and whatnot. I have coaches who will ask and welcome parents to provide food, bring food, whether that's pregame, after games, for the buses. At any time a parent wants to do that and pitch in, allow them to do that. And I have some coaches that say, you know, you can contribute treats after a game, but that's the only thing you are allowed to contribute, or you need to be on a rotation so that, you know, we don't have one mom or one dad bringing treats after every single game and all of a sudden becoming like that parent that is like, oh, they're always bringing us the sweets and the goods and whatever, you know, like, so it's, those are things you might want to be thinking about. You maybe have seen some of this stuff play out in your own teams and are thinking, well, I don't want that to happen. I don't want my parents to be involved that way. I don't want parents to do that. Or I would love for parents to do that when I have a team, and you can encourage certain behaviors as well, right? I do think providing opportunities for where parents can be involved is helpful. So that when you are delivering your message, that not everything is you can't, but it is, these are the things I'd love to see you do. And then here are some, you know, expectations I have and how you behave in these certain situations, right? Whether that's behave with me after a game or address me about certain concerns you have. This is how I prefer, this is the method I prefer in which you deliver it. So instead of saying what they can't do, it's like how they can do something. I think is going to be more encouraging to parents to trust that you're still open to their involvement, but it has to be in a certain way that is the same for everyone to access, right? And that is why it's so important, because if you have a parent who is gutsy enough to come up and talk to you about something and address something, and another parent gets wind of that or understands that that's happened, then all of a sudden you're going to be like, well, you know, what's going to stop other parents to start coming to talk to you? And you want to be able to control that avenue of communication. When I coached, I didn't have any parents. I didn't allow any parents to text me. I told them if they had a concern or wanted to talk to me about something, they needed to call me or email me. And I don't know what it was about that, but for some reason I just think texting is so simple and easy. You can pick up your phone and do it. But to actually pick up the phone and call someone and commit to a phone call, I really felt like they had to be, like, that was a commitment, right? So, and then an email, you know, was kind of similar in that you had to sit down and commit to that, to write out that email. But I also liked the email for documentation, which I think is also another aspect of dealing with parents, is that you document things. So email is a great way, because obviously it's already there and documented. If they did call me, I would follow up with an email to say, per our conversation, this is what we discussed, right? So that there was a formal document. And if they had something to say in return that they felt like wasn't accurate about what I said, or they had additional things to add or to comment on, that I had that in writing. So I do think that with all of this and with any interaction you have with parents, documentation is crucial. So even if it happens to be a in-person exchange, as quickly after that as you can, try to jot down what happened in that exchange so that you have it as documentation of what occurred in the conversation you had. So that's why I also think having a preseason meeting or a letter is helpful, because if you do have an issue with a parent later on, you can show like, oh, well, in this parent agenda, and here's kind of my notes from that agenda, I discussed these things or I addressed it, or here in my letter to my parents, I addressed this behavior, and what my desires were with that. And then that can be something you refer back to when you talk to a parent. Like, remember in the letter, I told you I wasn't going to discuss playing time with you. I wasn't going to do it. So this is a conversation that's going to end right now. And then boop, you're done. That's it. You don't even have to address anything else with that. And if they keep pushing it, you say, I'm not addressing that with you. I'll address it with your son or daughter if they want to come talk to me about it, but I'm not addressing it with you. I've made that very clear. Like, you don't know everything that goes into making this decision. And you're not there every day at practices to understand and see how those moments help me make these decisions. So that makes it easy for you to end conversations that you don't want to entertain or feel like you have to entertain when you put those things out there ahead of time and you're proactive. And then it helps then for you to document what you discussed. So that was a lot of broad things that I think are valuable to think about and to grasp and manage. Okay, so that is all that stuff. Then I just want to address some of the kind of specific questions that you had. I sort of feel like I addressed the whole playing time question through all the things I just talked about, but I think a big thing is try to be as clear as you can with your athletes what their role is on the team and what you do anticipate seeing their contributions being. And if you have to update them and, you know, and if that changes or you have to take back something you said, like if you thought they were going to play more and they end up not playing as much as you thought, you know, sort of a few games into the season, or if it changes throughout the season, I readdress that with them and rediscuss that with them and try to be as clear as possible, because that alone can alleviate issues with people having concerns about playing time. A parent may be frustrated that their child's not playing, but if the child can look at them and say, well, listen, coach said I was maybe going to play 2 minutes a game, if that, or I'm only going to get in if we're really far ahead, or coach said I'm going to be the second, you know, backup, I'm second string down the depth chart or whatever, right? So if you're clear about that, or try to be as clear and as honest about that as you can, that can help. But then beyond that, if a parent does come up to you and you haven't made it clear that you won't discuss playing time, like you haven't said that to parents so they don't know that, or whatever, you know, or you're letting a parent discuss this with you, I think it's really important to let them know that there are lots of things that go into decisions with playing time that they can't begin to understand. And even in the case where a player might be skilled and or veteran on a team, right? Like they're an upperclassman and they are a skilled player, it may be that they do not mesh well with the team dynamic. I mean, that happened a lot. As a team, as a coach of a team sport, I had athletes that had some pretty talented skills individually. But when they got them on the court with four people around them, holy buckets, it was a disaster. They were like an X factor in why the team kind of fell apart, like no composure, no consistency, no chemistry. And those things are critical when you're talking about a team sport. And so there are things like that. And if you've addressed that with that player, they may have a really hard time telling their parent that. And if that is the case and you haven't addressed that with the player, you need to find a way to tell them that. Like you have people to say to them, listen, you're not playing well with others on the floor. I haven't found a combination that you fit well within. And it's those conversations stink, especially if they are an upperclassman and they do have some talent. But in all reality, that's true. That can happen, and that's hard. You're also going to have cases where you have players who work super hard. They work their heart out. They work harder than anybody else on the court, and they just aren't talented enough. And to have to look at them and say, I know you're working super hard, but unfortunately, your hardest working effort doesn't surpass the talented players, the talent that some of the players have above you, even if they're not working as hard as you. You may be fine to reward that person and let them play. I've certainly done that. You know, I've found places to insert players like that, but they're still only going to get limited minutes, because in the end, if your goal is to help the team be successful and win, you can't play someone who can't produce. And that's just the harsh reality of it. And honestly, it's a good life lesson that sometimes we're going to work super duper hard and we're still not going to get that promotion or that bonus or the opportunity to have that job, that specific position we are just so wanting to have, because we may work super hard, but we may not be the best fit or we may not be the most talented. And that is a hard life lesson, but boy, sports, if you're honest with your athlete, can really teach someone what that looks like to work super hard at something and end up not fulfilling an opportunity that you were hoping to fulfill. So as honest as you can be with players, the better, the more you can let them know how things change, the better. So if they were playing and they're playing less and less, if you can identify for them why, all those things are going to help, because they are going to say those things to their parents if their parents are getting really crazy with, like, getting on them. Or if they choose not to because they're just not willing to tell their parents, or they're embarrassed or they're frustrated too. You can at least know, like, deep down, they do know. They do know. And you know they know because you have verbalized it to them. And then that's their issue to manage, right? So that's my best suggestion with you with playing time. That's difficult. Now, somebody brought up a question about if a parent is actually has a legitimate concern about an athlete on the team, about their child and their role and how much they're contributing. And it's actually legitimate, but the issue is that the parent is just goes about it in all the wrong ways. They have a terrible approach to it. And that's the problem, is like how they're addressing the issue. Then that goes back to having that preseason meeting, letter, whatever, because again, if you lay out how you expect them to address those kinds of concerns, then you can just go up to that parent and say, listen, I just want to bring to your attention. There's a little bit of a concern here that you have an issue, or you have a concern with so-and-so's playing time, your daughter, your son's playing time. And you're concerned about that and you're vocalizing that. And while there may be some things there to look at and to discuss, the way you're going about this isn't healthy. It isn't effective. It's inappropriate. Like, you just have to be honest with people and say that, because if you want to eliminate that behavior, you have to be honest about what the behavior is that you want to eliminate it and why, right? And so you really just have to be able to go up to them and say, like, this is the deal. It's going to be super hard for you to do that when you're a younger coach. Trust me. I know. I get it. But if you're really concerned about having a conversation like that, bring your assistant with you, so that they hear that you've delivered that message, so that if there's any concern from the parent or they want to kind of push back on you, then when you go and tell your administrator that you had this conversation with this parent who's being difficult, the assistant coach can vouch for you and say, yes, I was there. That's exactly what they said. And this is how it was addressed. And, you know, then hopefully your administrator will back you up. So, with that being said, I think it is also important that you do let administrators know if any kind of interesting or elevated interactions happen with a parent, that you let your administrator know, to just say, like, hey, listen, after the game, I had this parent come up to me and try to address me about something they were very frustrated with. And you can look at that administrator and say, listen, this is how I address that person. You've seen it. I send this letter out, or you saw my parent agenda. I address this at my parent meeting that they're not allowed to talk to me after games. Like, they're not allowed to come to me and talk to me at games about issues that they have. And I just tried to remind that parent of that, and they got very vocal with me. So you just kind of give that athletic, or you try to just give that administrator, like, an overview of what happened, so that they know and they can think about, like, how they need to be prepared to address that if that parent comes around to them and talks to them, or tries to approach the administrator about the interaction, right? So that's part of documentation too, is bringing that to your administrator. And when you verbalize and you are in communication with your administrator, they're gonna back you up more often than not, especially if you can say, like, these are my policies and I made that clear with the parents at the beginning of the season, and this parent overstepped their boundaries and I was reminding them of that. It's going to be hard for an administrator to be like, well, why did you do that, right? Because an administrator should be logical and rational to say, you're right, the parent didn't have a place. They were out of place to do that. So be as honest as possible. And if a parent does have a legitimate concern, but it's the way they're addressing the concern, honestly, that's what you just have to say to them. Like, your concern could be valid, and I'm willing to look at your concern, but the way you're approaching this is just, it's not healthy or helpful. You can use kind of whatever word there you want to use. Let's see, I'm just looking at my list of other things. So somebody raised the specific question about playing time. Actually, a couple of you, a specific question about playing time in college. It is remarkable how that is happening more and more, that parents at the college level are complaining about playing time. And again, just, you have to have confidence in what you're doing. Know that these parents are only coming to you from one singular perspective, and that is that they want their own kid to play. And you just have to do your best to just remind that parent that you know best. And these are the decisions that are made in conjunction with discussions with your staff. And because of, however, you know, practice time, all of the things that go into it. And again, like, if you've made it clear in the beginning of the season you're not going to discuss that, then you don't even have to say anything else. But I already told you that I'm not going to discuss playing time. If your child has an issue with it, they can come talk to me. And full stop. And that's it, right? So if you have a concern about that, or if you've had a special situation you want addressed further than what I'm discussing, or if you have been in a situation where a coach doesn't do anything proactively to address those kinds of concerns, then send me an individual message, you know, call me or email me, and I'll talk you through maybe some suggestions on how to address that specifically. I think the last one is, really aggressive parents. A couple of you talked about the fact that you have experienced really vocal parents in the stands. One of you actually talked about a parent that got kicked out a lot from games, from competitions. And like, how do you address that? How do you try to get that parent to, like, how do you address them in a positive way? How do you approach them so that they'll listen to you about your concerns? So I don't know. I think that's frustrating. And to me, it's a little sad that a parent can't just try to enjoy the sporting experience and like wanting to positively support their child and their child's friends. So I think that's unfortunate, but obviously just because you feel bad about that or are frustrated by that, it's not going to change the behavior. So you need to make a decision about who would be best to address that parent. So if it's you as the head coach, and you know you're the only person that that parent will mostly listen to, you need to address them. If it's more of an authoritative figure, then you need to talk to your administrator to say, I need help in addressing this player. Parent. So if you think it's that, like it needs to be more of an authoritative figure, then you should think about it, talking to your administrator and saying, we need to address this parent. If it's a parent that seems to have gained a relationship with someone on the coaching staff, then maybe they're the person, right? And that can happen. It's very possible that a parent has kind of created a good communicative relationship with someone on the coaching staff that's not the head coach. It's not you. And that's okay. I think that's perfectly fine. Then maybe that's the person that approaches them. But you need to figure out who's the best person to address this parent. And not the player. Do not put the player in that position, because that's pretty hard. But to address that parent and really just identify to them that it's a problem that they're getting thrown out because it's because of their behavior, and that it's not a good reflection of your program. You don't want your program to be reflected by obnoxious parents that can't even stay in the stands because they're getting kicked out. And that's not what you want your program to be represented with or as. Because your fans are a reflection of your program just as much as your players and your coaching staff are. And so that could be a way that you address it, and to really give them kind of an ultimatum. Like, you either need to clean up your behavior and actions, stop getting kicked out, be more positive on the sidelines, or if you can't, don't come, or the next time you get kicked out, you're not allowed to come to any games at all. I mean, literally. And you have the right to do that. And if your administrator says you don't have the right to do that, then I think you need to think about how you address them, about how they're, what they're doing in terms of how they're how their own son or daughter is, what they're doing to them in terms of that reflection of their own son or daughter and getting kicked out, being obnoxious, et cetera, you know? So I think you have to just consider, I mean, if fans get kicked out of events, they certainly can be prohibited from coming to events, right? So if their behaviors their actions and their behaviors get them kicked out of an event, if they continue to do that, you tell them they're not allowed to come to events. It's just that simple. I mean, because again, like, you're tired of them getting kicked out. They don't need to be acting in a way as such that they get kicked out. So here's the deal. Like, either figure it out and clean up your behavior, or just don't come, because it's not helpful. It's not healthy. It's not a great environment for the kids to compete in. And if this is happening at the youth level, that's terrible. I mean, you know, and I'm sorry if you've had a parent like that, because it's just terrible. That's just hard to deal with and manage as you, as their kid, as the rest of the team that have to see their friend, like, experience that on a regular basis, as a coaching staff that's recognizing this is a reflection of your program, you know. So however you want to identify the problem to them, like why it's a problem, then you need to, that's what you need to address. You need to give them a clear, like, this is the expectation, and if it's not met, this is going to be the outcome. And you need to deliver that message to the person that you feel they're going to best respond to or listen to in terms of the seriousness of the message that you're giving to them. So that's that situation. And then the last one I think I'm going to address I think I've gotten to most of the questions or concerns that you guys raised was, somebody brought up a situation where an athlete had a parent that was really hard on them after every game. And it would be so bad in some instances where the athlete, when they were in the car ride home with the parent afterwards, made the parent stop the car, and the athlete, the child got out of the car and walked the rest of the way home, which could have been 1 or 2 miles. And that it made that child very upset, would cry, you know, be really distraught and beside themselves. Hi, honey. That's Maisie. That's Maisie. So you say hi?
Hi.
That's my class, honey. Hi, Mama's class. I'm almost done, honey. Okay. Yeah. That's a hard one too. It's a hard one because we don't really want to put yourself in a position where you now are becoming the person who's judging someone for what they're doing, right? Like, you don't want to be judged. You don't want to be criticized for something that you know parents don't understand that you do as a coach. So it's really hard to then put yourself in a position where you're doing that in return to a parent. But like the parent who was getting kicked out of games and competitions, this is a similar situation. I would first address the athlete to find out from them what's going on. Like, I've heard these things have happened. What's going on? Are you okay? Right? Because they're clearly not okay. If they've been crying a lot, if they're getting out of their car and walking home, I mean, this is not typical. So they're probably not okay. They're probably really struggling, the athlete. So that's the first conversation, is with the athlete, to ask them, are they okay? What can you do to help them and support them? And to then help them and support them, right? To remind them that sometimes your best support comes from outside your normal expected places, right? So while we all feel like maybe our parents would be our biggest fan and be our biggest support, sometimes our parents don't know how to best do that in a way that's the healthiest for us. So sometimes our biggest fans and supporters come from outside those regularly expected places. Maybe it's not our parents, maybe it is our coaches or our teammates or another set of parents in that regard. It's not to minimize the importance of actual parents, like birth parents, and their role in this, and to not say that they can't figure out how to do that better. But in cases where parents might be struggling to be good, constructively supportive fans of their own child, you might have to encourage that child to find that support in another, from another avenue, from another another figure, support figure. And then I really do encourage, if you can figure out who else on the team to provide some of that really uplifting, empowering support to that athlete, so that they know that they're cared about, they're cared for, they're not going to be overly criticized, and that they can do it, right? So I think that that's the first thing, is to provide that like safe space and support and help for that athlete. And then ask them if they, I think it's good to ask if they would like their parent addressed. Because it just may be a situation where it isn't the in the best interest for you to address it. I mean, honestly, like, I don't know, because some of these situations can be very tricky. If it's an abusive situation beyond what's happening in those moments after games for that athlete, if it's an abusive situation and the athlete doesn't want to reveal that to you or is not ready to have that confronted by someone, that's going to, you know, open up a whole Pandora's box of issues, then you shouldn't just necessarily approach a parent about it. That's my impression. Because I just, it could actually make it worse for that athlete, in those moments with their parent. And so it might just be the best approach to let that athlete know that you are their biggest fan and supporter. You're going to help them and try to get a couple of teammates around them to rally around them and help provide that support. If the athlete's like, yes, please talk to my parent about this, or could you please say something, or could you help me talk to them, which is the best case scenario, right, is to help them address their parent, then here we are again with, like, here's the concern we have. This is really what we would hope for, because we need you to uplift and give confidence to your child that is then going to help them perform better in our team setting. And then if you really can't do that, then we may find alternative ways for you to, for us to get your child back home after games and not have them ride with you, so that maybe you can take time to kind of cool off and, you know, think about how you're going to address your child than just berating them after a competition. That's just the best way that to approach any kind of difficult situation, is to say, you know, here's kind of what we're seeing. What's kind of your, like, how, do you see how we're seeing this? This is what we're kind of hoping we would expect. And then if not, this is sort of the outcome we're going to have to manage. So I guess that's probably, of all the ones that were submitted, that was the hardest one, because that's really extra situational and specific to every person. They can be, you know, that can be addressed and how it's addressed. I think the biggest thing in that situation is supporting the athlete from your perspective, what you can do to really give that person the support, love, and care that they need, because that's obviously something that they're kind of missing from based on the behavior that how the parent is treating them. And so really do your best to uplift that athlete. And if that's all you can do in that situation, that's going to be doing more than you might think, so that you can really, you know, remind them that you believe in them. And that's an important aspect, because you're their coach. So do what you can with those situations. Those are tricky situations. You might need to call on your administrators to help you. Or if you really legitimately are seeing issues of abuse and you really are concerned, then you do need to take that to your administration and talk to authorities about the concerns that you might be seeing. If you feel like there are legitimate abuse concerns, that's like real, right? So, but if it's something where you don't feel like that's actually the case, then it is about addressing the athlete and asking them if they want you to then talk to the parent, if that's okay with them to do. Okay. I think I addressed everything. I know this was a longer video. I mean, we could talk about parents for a long time. You know, they can present tricky situations, but parents can be so great too, right? Like, they can offer to, cook meals for your team, have the team over to their house for, you know, a big team, like scavenger hunt, movie night, etc. So parents can do great things, You know, they can do fire ups for your teams. They can just being in the crowd and cheering for your teams. I mean, obviously these are things that are so great. And parents in the end are just proud of their child for participating in sport. And while they may get frustrated in the end, if you are creating an environment that includes everybody and makes everyone's value realized and their worth understood, while parents may get frustrated, it's just like an athlete. They're going to get frustrated at times too and be, you know, bummed out about some things. But in the end, the whole experience is what they're going to remember. And if it's a great experience overall and you've created a great team environment and a great program to be proud to be a part of, parents are going to feel that same way too. So some of those isolated incidences are going to just be forgotten altogether. They're going to be water under the bridge. So remember that parents, you know, they are sensitive to their own child, but in the end, they're kind of like your athletes in that they're going to appreciate their child being a part of the program and them as parents being a part of the program. And, you know, think about how you can highlight the great things that they're doing for your program, and how that their support is really valued and you appreciate it. So I do think, and in closing, one of the things that you can do to help relationships with parents is when you feel comfortable having little conversations with them outside of game times. If you feel comfortable talking to them after games, you can do that, but don't do it only after times when you win. You have to be able to do that in times when you don't win either, and that's difficult. So think about the times when you feel like you can interact with them and talk with them, but thank your parents. Thank them for coming to games, for cheering on the team. If they've provided some kind of meal or treats to the team, send them a thank you. I used to actually do cards, handwritten thank yous from the team if it was like a big meal or something like that. If it was just treats for the players or things like that, I'd shoot them a quick email. In your postseason banquet, if you have that, or a program or any kind, thank your parents specifically to say to the parents, thank you for supporting your child, for being in our program, for, you know, being a part of our culture, etc. Right? Like, thank them, because showing that gratitude will get them to understand that even through the tough times, we're appreciative of you. We can't do this without you. Obviously, if you didn't support your child being a part of a program, we wouldn't have athletes here, right? So you do need to remember to thank your parents, and not just in one isolated incident, like one isolated situation, like an end of the year banquet, but throughout the season, find ways to thank parents, because that will go a long way as well when you show that you appreciate all the parents regardless of how much their child plays. Because remember, we don't judge our athletes by how much they play or don't play. We judge them by the people that they are. Not judge them, but we appreciate them for the people that they are. And so we hope that we would not get judged in return, or valued in return by how much their child plays, right? And the decisions that they think we should be making. So show gratitude to your parents. Try to be proactive with your messaging to your parents. Try to be as honest as possible with your athletes so that hopefully they can share that information with their parent and alleviate some of the issues. And when you do address concerns with a parent, please be sure that you are clear about what the concern is and why, how they can shift and change what they're doing, their behavior or their words or actions, and then what might be an outcome or a consequence if they don't change that behavior, so that everybody's on the same page. Document and be confident. Like, that's the last thing I'm going to say one more time. Be confident, because you know best what's best for your team always.